Hey everyone, welcome back to my YouTube channel. I hope you're having a beautiful day wherever you are in the world. And thanks so much for joining me for another art video. In today's video, I'm going to be sharing all about my 6 favorite alternative shading or mark making techniques. I'm going to be sharing my process for how I go about using each of these 6 techniques to shade a sphere. And I'm also going to be sharing my favorite tips that I always make sure to have in mind when I am using each that help me just arrive at better results. I'm gonna make sure to leave a timestamp for you right below this video in the description box in case you'd like to jump straight into the 6 techniques. But before getting into that, I would really like to just give you 5 key things that apply to all of the techniques that I'm gonna be sharing with you today that I think will be super, super helpful for you to understand so that you can be more successful with them, especially if you're just getting started with pen and ink and pen and ink shading. So the very first thing is that it's important for you to understand that with all of these techniques, you are using lines and marks to develop both values and textures simultaneously. Visual texture is created when you repeat a line or shape or mark over and over again. And so it's very important that when you're picking the alternative shading or mark making techniques that you're going to be using for a piece, that you take into account the texture that you might create with it. Because you may end up creating a texture that you weren't intending to create. It's very, very different from smooth shading techniques that you create with graphite and that kind of material, in which you can tackle developing different values, highlights, midtones, and darks, separately from developing texture. And not only this, but when we're working with graphite, we can go in and lighten and erase. And when we're using pen and ink, ink is a permanent medium. Once you've laid down that line or mark or shape or whatever it is, you cannot really take it back. And so because of these things, in my opinion, it's even more important to go in with some sort of at least basic strategy when you're going to be using alternative shading and mark making techniques. Which specific techniques are you going to be using? Are you going to be combining a few different techniques? Where are you going to be using each? Are you thinking of doing layering? If so, how much? And so on and so forth. I would highly recommend going in with some sort of strategy and doing your best to stick to that strategy for the piece. It's when we lose focus of that strategy and start getting sloppy or start working too fast that all of a sudden things end up looking very messy and we end up making mistakes that are difficult to take back and are difficult to integrate as part of the piece and make less noticeable. Point number 2 is that it doesn't matter what kind of alternative shading or mark making technique it is that you're using, you have to remember that the more paper you cover up, the darker the value, the less paper you cover up, the lighter the value. And when you're going for a 3D look, you want to make sure that you have these values in mind because it can be very easy to continue adding and adding and adding more lines or marks and end up covering more of that paper than you initially wanted to, and all of a sudden things end up looking very flat. And because of all of these things, it's super, super important that you're working with a great reference that allows you to see light areas, mid-tone areas, and darker areas. If you're using a reference photo that is overexposed or underexposed and you're not able to see a good balance of lights and darks, then it's highly likely that you're not going to be able to pinpoint them in your reference photo effectively enough so that you can actually make them happen in your drawing. So whether you're using a reference photo or are drawing or sketching something that you have in front of you in real life and are just using direct observation, make sure that there is a good lighting situation going on so that you're able to pinpoint different value areas so that you can make them happen in your piece. Remember that value is absolutely number 1 when it comes to developing any sort of 3D-ness or depth or volume. Key point number 3 is consistency. There is a lot of wiggle room and even space for imperfection
with alternative shading and mark making techniques, but you have to make decisions. Decisions like what angle you're going to be laying down those lines or marks in, how long those lines or marks are going to be, how much distance is going to be between those lines and marks, etc. And once you've made those choices, you have to make sure to stay as consistent as possible, at least with that group of lines or marks. Now, different artists use alternative shading techniques in different ways. Some of them have a very, very precise, more perfect kind of look to their marks. Others use them in a messier kind of way. But I think that if you see a piece that has depth and 3D-ness to it, there is always some sort of consistency and thought process involved. It's when you go in and just randomly start creating lines and marks and stop thinking about value and the 3D structure of the thing that you are sketching that things end up looking very messy, and you even start creating textures that you didn't want and start flattening areas out, etc. The fourth point that I want to share with you before getting into the techniques is that you have to learn about developing line weight variation. This is something that I've talked extensively about before in past pen and ink videos and tutorials. I'll make sure to link to them down below in the description box as well. Line weight variation is essentially avoiding creating lines and marks that have one consistent weight from start to finish. Instead of going for a coloring book page outline kind of illustration that is going to end up looking very flat and very cartoony, unless of course that's what you're going for, in which case that's awesome. Just know that when you're going for something that looks slightly more realistic and dynamic, you're trying to stay away from a very stark looking, obvious outline with one same thickness and consistency all throughout. You're looking to create lines and marks that have certain sections that are thinner and lighter and other sections that are heavier and darker. What I see a lot of beginners struggle with is with creating sketches that are very stiff, very heavy, they don't look very dynamic or interesting, and this is in large part due to the fact that they haven't yet gained control over their medium. And also, of course, and this happens to all of us, in the beginning, we're hesitating a lot. We don't have that confidence yet to go in and lay down lines and marks quickly. And this shows, because if you lay down a line in a quicker way versus more slowly, doing it more quickly, it may have imperfections, but you end up with a line that has a line weight variation throughout it, and it ends up looking a lot more dynamic. Versus if you go in and lay down the line super slowly and you're hesitating, that is going to lead to a stiffer looking line that is more likely to have a consistent weight from start to finish and even stop and start marks. So as I mentioned in a past pen and ink tips video, in my opinion, there are four main things that you can start really taking note of and practicing mindfully that will help you arrive at a better line weight variation in your pieces. Number one, there is the pressure that you're exerting on your pen. The greater the pressure, usually the heavier the line or mark, and the lighter the pressure, the lighter the line or mark, and you kind of have to get used to varying and altering and shifting and changing that pressure depending on the effects that you're going for. The second thing is the angle at which you're using your pen. If you're using an angle that is more of a 25, 30, 40 degree angle from your paper, then the ink is not going to flow down as quickly down that nib, which leads to a thinner, lighter line, versus when you use the pen at more of a 90 degree angle, more of a perpendicular angle to your paper, that ink is gonna flow down a lot faster, creating a darker, thicker line. Another thing is the speed. As I mentioned before, the quicker you move your arm and your wrist, usually that line is gonna maybe look tapered. So there's going to be a natural line weight developed, versus when you move your hand and your arm more slowly, that usually is gonna give that ink more of a chance to flow down more heavily, and you're gonna be left with more of a consistent line weight from start to finish. And finally, of course, there's varying the actual pen tip sizes that you're using. So if you're in control with the first three points that I just shared with you, the pressure, the angle, and the speed, you can just use one same pen tip size throughout the entire piece, and you're gonna be able to develop a nice variety of line weight, and you're gonna be able to create a lot of depth and contrast. But if you want to also use two, three, or more different pen tip sizes, of course, using a larger pen tip size is going to lead to a heavier, thicker line than a smaller pen tip size. All right, and the very final little thing that I wanna make sure to share with you before jumping into the techniques is I would highly, highly recommend taking breaks. Because as I said in one of the previous points, it's so easy when you're repeating a same line or mark or a similar line or mark to just keep going and going and going, and all of a sudden areas look overworked, they look flat, they look very heavy or whatever. And so what I like doing is making sure that I am taking breaks and coming back to see the entire piece as a whole. Oftentimes when I take those breaks, I just notice that I've done enough description and I really don't have to do anything else. So taking those breaks along your process is gonna help ensure that at the end, you're not gonna end up with a piece that looks too overworked. All right, so with all that out of the way, let's go ahead and jump straight into these exercises. So as you can see, I have drawn six circles on the sheet in my sketchbook. Right now, these are just plain flat circles. They are going to be turned into spheres once I shade them in and add a little bit more of a 3D look into them by developing different values throughout them, meaning highlights, midtones, and darks, and also adding a little bit of a cast shadow and occlusion shadow effect. So in order for me to do that and develop values that look believable, I first need to think of a light source. So I decided that the light source would be located somewhere in front of the sphere and above it, slightly more to the right side than to the left side. So these smaller circles that you're seeing me very lightly draw inside of the larger circles are sections that I wanna make sure to keep protected with little to no ink in them so that I can have that whiteness of the paper shining through, standing in place for my highlights. I wanna make sure that little to no ink is inside of this general area. And I'm also adding in another shape on the lower left side of the sphere opposite to the light source, because I'm gonna be adding in a little bit of a cast shadow and occlusion shadow effect. If you're just getting started with shading with pen and ink, I would highly recommend giving thought to the location of your light source and also mapping out these areas for yourself, because it's very easy to just start covering up everything with marks and all of a sudden you're gonna flatten everything out and you're not going to arrive at a believable 3D look. All right, so I'm all ready to go here. I finished up with my preliminary pencil sketch. I used an HB pencil, by the way, if you're interested. And I finished up by gently tapping my kneaded eraser over my pencil drawings so that I can soften that sketch even more. All right, let's go ahead and get started. And I'm gonna be using one of my Stadler pigment liners. And the size of this tip is 0.1. All right, so let's get into the first alternative shading technique that I'm gonna be sharing with you today, and this is going to be hatching. All hatching really is laying down straight parallel lines. These lines can be going off in any direction, but once you pick a specific angle for those lines, you have to do your best to stay as consistent as possible. Whenever I'm doing just one layer of hatching, I also make sure that there is a consistency in terms of the distance that I am leaving between each line. Now, if I were working on a drawing that includes many different elements in it or different sections of a subject, and I'm gonna be using hatching throughout, I don't have to use the same slant or the same angle for my lines that I use all throughout the piece. I could definitely combine hatching going off at different angles for the different elements or the different parts of my subject. However, I would approach each section as a specific group of lines, and within each group, I'm gonna try to stay consistent. All right, so as you can see, I finished up with my first layer of lines and I did my very best to stay away from that general area with that smaller circle. I'm doing my best to start my lines starting at the edge of the sphere and make my way in. Whether I start my line somewhere around the upper edge and I make my way in from there, or from the lower edge going upward. And this is because I want the tapered end of my lines to be in the innermost part of the sphere. That way, the thinner end of those lines is going to help me create that graded look in which the darker values are turning into lighter values in the central section of the sphere. And the darker values where I start those lines are in the section of the sphere that I'm going to be darkening, which are the outer edges. So right here, I'm working on continuing to layer that ink and those lines around the sphere in the sections of darker values that I wanna darken and push those values in. I continue filling in sections between my initial lines and doing overlapping of lines until I've arrived at a level of darkness around those edges and contrast that I like. I'm making sure to keep the quote-unquote shape that I create with those darker values very abstract and very irregular along those edges, because I know that if I create one same width all around the sphere for those darker values, that is also going to lead to a unnatural, flat, outline-y even kind of effect. So make sure to keep that darker shape very irregular and create irregular transitions into the lighter values. Also, one thing I want to take note of with these little studies that I am working on today is I am using way more lines than what I would actually use for quicker alternative sketches. With these little studies, I am working on smoother transitions between my values. And this is why I'm really taking my time doing much more overlapping and laying down way more lines than what I would usually do, because I am pushing for a little bit more of a 3D look. However, feel free to lay down a less amount of lines. It's still gonna be hatching. As I continue doing my layering, I make sure to stay focused and try to continue doing my best to pay attention to the initial slant and angle at which I started laying down those lines, because I want to continue using that same angle. All right, so I'm almost done here. I'm gonna use my soft graphite eraser to get rid of that pencil work that I had created. Which, by the way, if you're going to be erasing any pencil work, make sure that your ink has completely dried. And now I'm going to be moving on to adding lines in the cast shadow and occlusion shadow areas. So I pick a slant for those lines and I do my best to keep it consistent throughout this entire cast shadow section. And then I do some overlapping using that same slanted line in the occlusion shadow section. For those of you who are not aware of what the occlusion shadow is, it's the darker portion inside of the cast shadow and it's right next to the object or the subject. So the larger cast shadow area is the entire shadow shape, which is basically happening because the object or the subject is blocking the light from hitting the surface beneath it. And then the occlusion shadow is right below or right next to the object, and it is the darkest section inside of the cast shadow because it is the least affected by the light source, and also there is no reflected light reaching it. I'm doing my best to really lay down that line and lift up my pen and lay down that line and lift up my pen so that I don't have any lateral or sideways movements that are going to make that line look a little bit curved at the end or just have a different kind of look to it, because that's when we start getting sloppy and things start looking a little bit messy. All right, so as you can see, I was able to develop a bit of a 3D look with that hatching in the first sphere by developing a wide range of values, highlights, midtones, and darkest darks, and also by adding in a bit of a cast shadow. I am now starting to work on my cross hatching, which is the same as hatching. I'm still working on laying down relatively straight parallel lines and trying to keep a consistency as best as possible with this group of lines. But the difference between hatching and cross hatching is that when we're doing cross hatching, there is a second group of lines on top of the first group of lines that is intersecting and creating somewhat of a cross effect over that first group of lines. Now, again, just like with the regular hatching, there is no specific angle or direction at which you have to lay down these lines. As long as they are somewhat crossing on top of each other, the lines could be perpendicular to each other, creating 90 degree angles, or they could cross at different angles. It doesn't really matter. But whatever angles it is that you choose for your layers of lines, make sure that you stick with that angle. All right, so I'm just finishing up with my second layer of lines here, and you can see how I ended up with little teeny tiny squares or diamond shapes because I was laying down lines that were intersecting. You're gonna notice that with the second layer of lines, I don't get as close to that smaller circle that I created with the graphite when compared to the first layer of lines. And this is important to take a note of because when you are doing your overlapping with that second layer of lines, you're starting to create a darker value because you're starting with your overlapping, you're starting to cover up a greater amount of paper with more ink. And because I want those values to get lighter and lighter and lighter as they get closer to that highlight section, I kind of left that closest section to that circle free of that second layer. And once I was done with those first two layers, what I am doing right now is I am pushing darker value areas even more by once again filling in little gaps in between my lines and doing overlapping of my lines, especially along those outer edges that I want to deepen and darken values in. This will lead to covering up more paper in these areas, which will create a deeper, darker value. The more paper we cover up, the darker the value. I am continuing with the same angle or slant at which I was laying down those lines for my initial two layers. I am still paying close attention to that and doing my best to stay focused and keep those lines consistent in terms of that slant. And I am continuing to use tapered lines, starting along the edges of the circle and making my way in so that that thinnest final section of those tapered lines is in the central portion of the circle, and the root where I started that line, which is bound to look a little bit thicker, is along the outer edges, which I am looking to deepen and darken and create darker values in. After doing that, I got to work on the cast shadow and occlusion shadow sections. I started out with my initial layer of lines all throughout the cast shadow area, and what I am doing now is my cross hatching in the occlusion shadow area inside of that cast shadow. You can see the closest section of the cast shadow has only one layer of lines, and I wanted to leave it like that because I wanted it to look lighter than the other sections in the cast shadow where I created that cross hatching and layered the lines more. All right, moving on to weaving. Weaving is super fun. Depending on your personal strengths and weaknesses, you might find it easier or you might find it harder. Weaving basically entails creating smaller groups of shorter lines. These little lines can be going off or slanting in any direction, but notice how I am keeping those lines consistent in each little group. And notice how these groups are touching or intersecting at a certain point, except for the areas of lighter values that I'm going to be developing in the innermost section of the sphere.
as I am moving into the sphere and closer to those lighter value sections, I am even allowing myself to just add in one or two or three little lines, and I'm leaving those kind of floating by themselves, and they're not really touching another little group so closely. Essentially, the areas where you want to develop those darker values in, the more tightly compressed those little groups of lines are, they're touching in those sections. And as you're moving away from those darker values and into lighter value areas, they're more separated apart, and you're even adding in floating little marks as opposed to entire groups. Okay, so I would consider that to be my first layer there. And you can see how even with that first layer, I've already managed to develop a variety of values. But what I'm going in to do now is a second layer. I'm deepening and darkening darkest value sections just to up that contrast and create an even more 3D look. So with weaving, all I am doing is I am going in to fill in little triangles or little teeny tiny shapes that have been naturally created by the placement and the arrangement of these little groups of lines that I've laid down. Wherever I see little sections that I can go in and fill in with my pen, I go in and fill it. But at the same time, I'm also, just like what I did with the hatching and the cross hatching, I am filling in little sections in between the lines that I've already laid down with an extra line or two and overlapping lines to deepen and darken values in these areas. So I am paying attention to the direction of the slant of the little groups of lines that I had already laid down, and I'm just filling in those gaps in between those lines with another line or two, and I am overlapping just like what I did with the first two techniques. If you want to work on mid-tone transitions a little bit more in between the darker value areas and the lightest value areas, or you just notice that there is a very big step, obvious step, between very dark values and lighter values, go ahead and lay down more little groups of little marks to create those mid-tones. All right, so I jumped on to working on the cast shadow and occlusion shadow areas. Same thing, I first went in with my initial layer of little groups of lines, and I am now working on filling in little spaces between my lines to deepen and darken darker value sections in the occlusion shadow within that larger cast shadow. All right, so I'm all done with this weaving little sphere study, and here are my three first spheres with these first three techniques: the hatching, the cross hatching, and the weaving. So you can see how I've managed to develop a bit of a 3D look to these spheres by developing values throughout them and also adding in a cast shadow and occlusion shadow beneath and to the left of them. But at the same time, you can see how these three techniques led to very different textures throughout these spheres. And hopefully you can start getting an idea for how important it is to pick and choose the specific shading and mark making techniques that you're gonna be using, because it will lead to very different results at the end. And not only this, but by picking the right kind of alternative shading or mark making technique, you can even help enhance the 3D structure and also the texture of whatever it is that you're drawing. All right, you guys, let's move on to alternative shading technique number four that I'm going to be sharing with you today, and these are contour lines. I really love using this technique whenever I am drawing objects that have more curves to them or more complex things like hands or the human figure or things like that, because they really help enhance those curves throughout the 3D structure of that subject. For contour lines, imagine having rubber bands wrapped around the object or the subject that you are drawing. You can also imagine using some sort of thick black marker to draw lines around the object. Those black lines are basically what you're laying down. You really have to visualize and give thought to the three-dimensional structure of the object or the subject that you are drawing. If you've never practiced drawing contour lines before, I would recommend doing what I'm doing right now on screen, which is using a pencil to draw those initial larger contour lines so that you can then switch on over to your pen. And you can actually have a little bit of guidance with those lines that you lay down for yourself. And basically, you're just filling in the sections in between. These lines that you lay down with your pencil, these are contour lines in and of themselves. So just practicing that is a great start. And then if you want to take it a step forward and add in more lines, you can do so. But again, you don't have to add in as many lines as what I am doing today, because I'm really pushing for smoother transitions and just a smoother, more realistic look overall. As I continue filling in these spaces in between my pencil lines, I am really doing my best to stay consistent with those curves that I have initially visualized with my pencil work. For many of us, drawing curves is more challenging than drawing straight lines. And it's even more important to stay focused along the process so that you can make sure that those curves really make sense in terms of those contour lines that you initially visualized. The curves are gonna be wider and less pronounced in the widest section of the sphere. And in the top and in the bottom, they get more and more curved or more and more closed. All right, so once I finish with my first layer, I am now going in with my tapered lines. These are now tapered curved lines, but once again, I am adding them in the outer edges of the sphere, starting at the outer edge and making my way in for that tapered look. The idea is the same. I am still paying attention to those curves, and I am filling up the spaces between those initial lines that I laid down and doing overlapping until I arrive at a level of darkness and 3D-ness and contrast that I like. And right here for my cast shadow, you can see how I also went in with curves and I did overlapping in that occlusion shadow area to deepen and darken values here. Okay, moving on to scribbling, you guys. Scribbling is also super, super fun. But you do need to loosen up that wrist and that arm and really just let go. Allow your wrist and that pen to do their thing as you continue creating loops and little lines going off to different directions. You want to keep everything super irregular and not think of anything too organized or too patterny. It is not necessary to always have contact with your paper as you're doing your scribbling. I do lift my pen up every now and then just continue in another spot. With scribbling, I do have a pressure in mind because I am not laying down individual lines or marks, and I am moving in and covering up a larger area faster with kind of one same line, one long, loopy and curling line. I do make sure that in the innermost section where I am trying to develop lighter values, I'm not pressing down as hard or exerting as much pressure on my paper when compared to the pressure that I'm exerting on the outer edges where I really want to overlap that scribbling and develop darker values. So make sure that you have pressure in mind with this one. In the innermost sections closest to the highlights, you want to make sure that you're not really pressing down hard at all, and your loops and irregular lines are kind of less tight. And as you're making your way out towards the midtones and the darkest darks, your loops can be tighter and you're overlapping your lines more and more to deepen and darken values. I'm not ever really pressing down too much with any of these techniques because I'm really trying to stay away from scratching or damaging my paper. But really with this particular technique, I'm barely touching the paper at all when I get closer to the highlight. Very similarly to how when I was laying down those tapered lines for the previous techniques, I was barely touching the paper at all as I was moving in into the highlight section. Okay, moving on to the final technique that I'm going to be sharing with you today, and this one is stippling. So stippling is probably, at least in my opinion, the easiest but the most time-consuming alternative shading technique of all, because you have to fill this area with individual little dots or shapes. created by gently pressing down the tip of your pen on your paper. It's harder to go wrong or make a mistake because you're going in with very small individual dots or marks, but it does require a lot of patience. And what's kind of hard to do, at least for me with stippling, is if you start getting impatient and sloppy, you can start moving your pen sideways or laterally in any particular direction, and this is going to lead to creating a little line or mark, as opposed to a little teeny tiny dot or shape that you are creating by pressing down the nib of your pen. And in the past sections of this video, I've talked about how important it is to stay consistent throughout your process. So if you start accidentally creating those little marks instead of little tiny dots or shapes because you're getting impatient and are starting to move your pen in different ways, that is going to create inconsistency and a stark looking little mark somewhere in your sphere, and it can be very distracting or stark looking, or you can even start creating, again, a texture that you weren't intending to create. All right, so I finished up with that initial layer of little tiny dots all throughout the sphere, and now I am working on what I'd refer to as the second layer. So you can see how I am deepening and darkening values mostly around the sphere, covering up more paper around the sphere for a bit of a 3D look. Very similarly to what I was doing before with the lines, I am filling in the little gaps between my initial dots in that first layer with a second and even third layer of dots. This is gonna make it so that these little dots or shapes are closer together. They're more clustered, more tightly together in the outer edges, and they are more separated apart as I am moving into the lighter midtones and the lightest lights. I'm gonna be doing the exact same thing for my cast shadow and occlusion shadow. Initially, I'm gonna go in with the first layer all throughout the cast shadow area. And then I am going to approach the occlusion shadow by layering more dots, adding more dots so that the ones in the occlusion shadow area that I want to make darker than the entire cast shadow shape are closer together, more compact together. I'm going to continue focusing and taking my time with this, making sure that I'm creating a nice gradual transition between my darker values and my lighter values. Continue coming back to the entire sphere, noticing if there is a very stark kind of transition or step between your dark values and your lighter values, because if so, maybe you have to add more dots into the mid-tone area so that you can create more of a gradual transition. And with that, we are all done with these six little sphere studies. I would love to know which technique you liked most, which one came more naturally to you, which one you struggled with more, and which of these you think you'll be using more in your own work. Remember that just like with any other art making related skill, being able to use these techniques effectively requires practice and time and patience. I have been practicing with pen and ink for around 5 years, and I have made a lot of progress by staying consistent with my practice, but I still have a long way to go before getting to the point that I want to be at. Did you enjoy this tutorial? I really, really hope you did. And if so, please make sure to check out everything that I'm offering over at my Patreon membership website, because for a very small amount a month, you get immediate access to my most exclusive resources in the form of real-time, step-by-step, fully narrated tutorials that I don't share anywhere else. All of the tutorials that I share over on Patreon include my downloadable outline sketch, my high-resolution reference photos, and my supply list, including the list of specific colors that I use for the piece on hand. Patreon community members also have access to my weekly sketchbook prompts, which are designed to help you stay consistent and making progress as an artist. There's also a library of classes on art fundamentals that now has over 20 classes in it and that gets added to each and every month. Monthly live Q&A sessions with me, in which community members get to ask me anything they'd like. feedback from me on your work, and much, much more. So go ahead and check it out. There are different tiers that you can join that give you access to different things, so you can pick whichever one you need. I'm gonna make sure to leave a link to that down below in the description box.
All right, you guys, that is gonna do it for today's video. I really hope that you found some helpful nuggets in it, that you found it inspiring, and if you did, pretty please, I'd super appreciate it if you give this video a thumbs up and share with family or friends who you think would find it helpful as well. That really helps support the work that I am doing here on YouTube and allows others to get to know about my channel. Thank you so much for watching today. Don't forget to subscribe so that I can see you next week for another video, and keep on creating. Bye guys!